Here in this place, God welcomes those who wander and those who worry. Here, those who believe and those who doubt can call on God by name. Here in this time, we remember how God has shown us love. And here in this faith space, we seek our God of love together.
Come all you people, come and praise the Most High. Come all you people, come and praise the Most High. Come all you people, come and praise the Most High.
Service, and we will read together responsively. We wait in quietness for God.
Our hope comes from God.
In the silent places of our souls, we turn to God.
For God alone is our rock of salvation.
The realm of God is not far from any one of us. For in God we live and move and have our being. As we read together our invocation, followed by the Lord's Prayer. Loving God, through Jesus you revealed the depth of your love and the breadth of your grace. Renew us with your life-giving Spirit and restore us with your life-giving love. Through Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, our Father, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. A very warm welcome to everyone this morning. We're so glad that you could be with us today. And whether you sit in our sanctuary or whether you're watching the video at home, we hope that you know that the heart of our church is summed up in these words. No matter who you are or where you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. Following the service, everyone is invited to join us for fellowship time downstairs in our parish hall for coffee or tea or something to munch on. If you are a visitor and you would like to know more about our church family, or if you have a prayer request, you can enter all of the information there on the welcome cards that are found in the pew rack in front of you and place it in one of the collection boxes, or you can give it to an usher or one of the ministers. Today is a family Sunday, meaning our youth and children are participating in worship, and you'll see our youth serving as ushers later on. Today at 11:30 a.m., Seeds of Faith will meet downstairs in the North Lounge for a discussion of the book, The Legend of Sheba, Rise of a Queen. Details can be found in your order of worship. This Friday, January 27th, all youth are invited to our home at 6 p.m. for a lasagna dinner, a movie, and a service project. This is an important and required announcement. The annual meeting of the Congregational Church of Manhasset will be held at 11:30 a.m. on February 5th on Zoom. We will have an abbreviated service that morning and no fellowship time. Financial reports are available in the sanctuary narthex and presented at the Zoom meeting. The following trustee terms of office will be completed: Phil Federa, Susan Getting, and Ed White. A quorum of 50 members on Zoom is needed to conduct business. And the Zoom link has been emailed to you and will be emailed again prior to the meeting. And finally, our stewardship campaign continues with the reminder that you need our church and our church needs you. If you haven't already, please consider filling out an estimated giving form in support of our 2023 budget. You'll find these forms in the pew racks in front of you. And we greatly, greatly appreciate your support. Also, please note that the 2023 offering envelopes are available in the sanctuary narthex. For our prayers this week, we want to remember those suffering following the mass shooting in Los Angeles. Today, we have a blessing to announce. We give thanks for the birth of Trent Joseph Tremblay, born on January 15th, weighing in at an even 8 pounds. Congratulations to his parents, Britta and Adam Tremblay, his sister Emery, and his grandparents, Margaret and Ernie Lampeter. So congratulations to the family. And now at this time, as I invite our children to come forward for a children's message, I'd like to invite everyone else, if you're able, to please stand and greet those around you. Not that she needs any introduction, but our scripture lesson today is from Charlotte Burgess.
Today's scripture is from the book of Jonah. It says, "Now the word of the Lord came to Jonah, son of Amittai, saying, 'Go at once to Nineveh, that great city, and cry out against it, for their wickedness has come up before me.' But Jonah set out to flee to Tarshish from the presence of the Lord. He went down to Joppa and found a ship going to Tarshish. He paid his fare and went on board to go with them to Tarshish, away from the presence of the Lord. But the Lord provided a large fish to swallow up Jonah. And Jonah was in the belly of the fish for 3 days and three nights. Then the Lord spoke to the fish, and it vomited Jonah out onto the dry land. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, 'Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim it to the message that I tell you.' So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh according to the word of the Lord. In the reading of these words, may we hear the word of the Lord. Amen."
And now, if you will take your order of service, we will read together our call to prayer. We are created in the image of God. We walk in the presence of God. We live surrounded by the love of God. In the power of the Spirit, let us pray to God. Most merciful God, who grants us second chances and renewed strength, we praise you for all those times when you have helped us try again, for all those moments when you encouraged us to follow your way. We give you thanks. Help those who need second chances to seek them, and those who need your empowerment to feel it. Oh God, we know that there are many in our world and our community who need your help this day. And so we pray for those who are suffering in Los Angeles as a result of the shooting. We pray that those in critical care might pull through. And we pray that we might somehow put an end to all of the suffering. God, we're thankful today too. We're thankful for the birth of Trent Joseph Tremblay. May he grow up to be full of faith and hope and love. And now, O God, hold us close and never let us go. So let it be. Amen. Jesus said, "It's more blessed to give than to receive. Please give as you are able."
Thank you.
is good to be back after some sickness. I appreciate all of your prayers during that. I'm here this week, but next week I'm going to be celebrating Christmas down in Tennessee. Some of us didn't get to make that flight home, and so we're going to get to go tomorrow. So I won't see you next week, but I won't be sick, although I will be full of lots and lots of pork. Barbecue, pulled pork, sausage, anything you want in pork, you can get it down there. So I will look a little porked the next time. Why is it that the Bible stories our children love the most can be among the most objectionable upon closer examination? It all starts with Adam and Eve at peace in the animal kingdom in the Garden of Eden. All is well with the happy couple until they eat the forbidden fruit. And then, boom, one strike and they're out of the garden forever. Where's the second chance in that story? What about Noah in the ark? Who doesn't love the story about cuddly animals boarding the boat two by two? In reading the whole story through, though, it's about God killing everyone except Noah's family with a worldwide flood. What's with that? Where's our God of second chances in that story? Despite my concerns, I continue to read these stories because I do believe that they contain valuable lessons, lessons that we might miss at first glance. Today's scripture lesson falls in the same category. It's the story of Jonah and the whale. Okay, being true to the original Hebrew text, it's actually the story of Jonah and the giant fish. How are we to interpret this story? On the one hand, there's the whole issue of a person who failed to follow God's way, ending up as fish bait. That's harsh. On the other hand, I love what it says about God and second chances. Some people read the story literally. They believe that Jonah was a real person who survived in the belly of the fish for 3 days and lived to tell about it. Others read it symbolically, as a story that illustrates the relationship between God and people. No matter what your take, the message comes through loud and clear, and I don't believe it's a finger-wagging threat of what will happen if we disobey God. I believe it's a message of forgiveness and mercy, of God's unfailing love. To me, the book of Jonah is all about second chances. First, there is the prophet Jonah. To say he was a reluctant prophet is putting it mildly. When he heard God's call to go to Nineveh and preach the need for repentance, Jonah quite literally took off in the other direction. Instead of going to Nineveh as commanded, Jonah made a beeline for the seaport of Joppa to hop a ship to Tarshish. Why did Jonah flee? There are several possible answers. For starters, many people in ancient times believed that gods occupied a particular territory. Thus, fleeing a country meant getting out from under the jurisdiction of that region's gods. This would mean that Jonah wasn't just running away from his homeland, Israel, but that at the most basic level, he was trying to run away from God. There are other reasons why Jonah may have run. Nineveh, a non-Jewish city, was not exactly the kind of place any Israelite, much less a prophet, would choose to hang out just for fun. Going there meant sticking his neck out. So Jonah may have run for fear. Perhaps there was an issue even deeper than fear. The problem that might be surprised to find in one of the prophets, namely prejudice. Jonah, a proud Israelite, may have rather seen God destroy Israel's enemies, the Ninevites, than give them the opportunity to repent and be spared. After all, Israel had actually fought wars with these people and despised the whole lot of them. God, on the other hand, saw something else. God saw the possibility of a people who might be receptive to the divine message of love and grace. And Jonah was chosen by God. Jonah was a guy with all of these shortcomings, just like everyone else. And yet God chose him to deliver the message. Even though Jonah refused God's request and took off in the other direction, our God of second chances did not give up on him. On the contrary, God let Jonah know that the God of Israel was not limited to one place, and that allowing a great storm to toss the ship to and fro might be a way of remembering this. So Jonah is on the boat. The frightened sailors prayed to their gods as the boat was tempest-tossed, and they were displeased when they learned that Jonah was in the belly of the ship, sleeping like a baby. They hauled him up on deck and asked him why he was not praying to his God. The sailors decided to cast lots to see whom the culprit might be, who among them might have angered a god. When Jonah arose as the offender, they asked what had he done to offend his God. Jonah spared them the details and urged them to throw him overboard because he felt sure that the sea would instantly calm. I find it curious that the same man who ignored God's message to preach to the Gentile Ninevites showed mercy to these Gentile sailors. They hesitated to toss him overboard and tried valiantly to keep the ship afloat until the very last minute. Then and only then did the sailors throw Jonah overboard, and sure enough, the tempest ceased. Was this the end for Jonah? No, not at all. Our God of second chances sent a great fish to rescue Jonah with one giant gulp. Finally, Jonah does what he should have done all along. He prays, and in so doing, agrees to let God call the shots. This reluctant prophet, who was determined to be his own man and go his own way, finally submitted to the call of God upon his life. In the belly of the fish, in the depths of the sea, Jonah is granted a second chance. And this time, he doesn't miss the boat, so to speak. The fish spits Jonah on the beach, and again God tells him to go to Nineveh. This time, he goes and proclaims God's message of warning through the shortest sermon ever given. Only 7 words in the English text. He went and he cried out to all of Nineveh, "In 40 days, Nineveh will be overthrown." That was his sermon. I guess you're jealous of those short sermons sometimes, aren't you? That's it. The text tells us that the people believed Jonah's prediction and accepted the prophecy from Israel's God. Throughout the city, the people repented by fasting and wearing sackcloth, which is kind of like burlap. And then our God of second chances granted them a reprieve. God decided not to allow the city to be overthrown after all, and the people were spared. It would be a much happier story if it ended right there. but it doesn't. Jonah, who should have learned his lesson in the midst of the storm-tossed seas, who should have learned his lesson in the belly of the fish, who should have learned his lesson when God gave him a second chance, becomes angry that the Ninevites were spared. Yes, Jonah is an unusual prophet. He actually gets ticked off when his listeners do exactly what he says. In all honesty, Jonah didn't want the people to repent. He wanted them to get what they deserved. He wanted grace for himself and swift justice for others. Forgiveness for himself, punishment for his enemies. And while that seems crazy, it's also very human. I think most of us can relate to these feelings. At the end of the story, God uses an object lesson, an attempt to show Jonah the need for grace. However, the story ends right there. There is no resolution, just a big fat question mark. We never find out if Jonah remains unmoved or moves toward understanding God's grace. If he comes to appreciate the second chances he's received from God or the chances God offers others. We could wait around for the sequel on Netflix, but thousands of years have come and gone since the original, and I think our wait would be in vain. So we don't know. Truth be told, we will never know. The important thing here is not Jonah's response, but God's response. Time and again, the scriptures tell us that God doesn't give up on us. That while God sees who we are, God also sees who, with God's help, we can become. As Kathleen Norris writes in her book, Amazing Grace, Peter denied Jesus and Paul persecuted the early Christians, but God could see the apostles they would become. Even when we try to run away from our troubles, God will find us, even when we feel the most alone. God will find a way to let us know that God is with us even in this place, wherever we are. And maybe that's one reason we come to worship, to respond to God's grace. We praise God not to celebrate our own faith, but to give thanks for the faith God has in us. The faith God has in us. That's an original idea, and I love it. Thank you, Kathleen Norris. For as different as we all can be, we all need second chances. We've all said things we wish we hadn't. We've let anger and fear cloud our judgment. We've all done things we regret. The Apostle Paul says, we've all fallen short of the glory of God. But the God of second chances doesn't hold it against us. The God of second chances encourages us to become more, to move beyond our self-limitations, to be our better selves. Of course, forgiveness neither spares us from natural consequences, nor frees us from responsibility. As Jesus taught, we reap what we sow. We will have a second chance, but we may have set in motion a chain of events that is now out of control. We may not like the consequences, but God will abide with us as we face them. Fortunately, every morning is a second chance. A chance to follow God's way, a chance to love God with all our hearts and all our souls and all our minds and all our strength and our neighbors as ourselves. It's our chance, and it's our choice. While God won't do it for us, I believe that God is with us when we're running away from our problems, with us in the depths of despair, in the belly of the fish at the bottom of the sea, with us in Nineveh when we are pushed into doing the right thing while wishing we were doing the wrong thing. And here's the bottom line. God is with us wherever we go, whatever we do. God is with us through thick and thin. In his day, Jesus promised the people a sign, what Jesus called the sign of Jonah, which they didn't understand at the time. For Christians, Jonah prefigures Jesus. As Jonah was swallowed by the fish, so Jesus was swallowed by death. When the fish spits Jonah on the shore after 3 nights, he is symbolically reborn. On Easter, when Jesus is freed from his tomb after 3 days, he is more alive than ever. No symbolism required. That's what Jesus called the sign of Jonah. The good news is that wherever we find ourselves, in the dark belly of the sea or facing a Roman cross, God is with us. Where there is God, there is hope. The kind of hope that kept Jonah alive in the belly of the fish, the kind of hope the women felt on that Easter morning, peering into Christ's empty tomb. The kind of hope that will buoy us up in turbulent times and bring us joy when life is tranquil. The sign of Jonah, the sign of Jesus, a reason to take God up on the offering of a second chance. Amen.
Thank you.
As we go forth, may God open our eyes to see the opportunities before us, open our hands to new ways of caring, open our minds to new possibilities, and open our hearts to dream new dreams. Through the love of Christ and the power of the Spirit. Amen.
God save the Lord, hear me.